better understand and evaluate mold rubber for your own use, you need to know a few important terms. With the exception of latex, mold rubbers are compounds, meaning that they have two parts, part A and part B. Part A is always in a yellow container, and part B is always in a blue container. The mix ratio of a mold rubber lets you know the proper proportion, either by weight or volume, of part A to be mixed with part B before applying over your model. Mix ratios will vary from product to product and are always listed on the SmoothOn technical bulletin for that product. What does a product's mix ratio mean to you? Make sure you know the mix ratio of the rubber product you are using. You must be accurate in measuring out parts A and B. If you are not, the rubber will not cure properly, or may not cure at all. If you are using a rubber that has a by-weight mix ratio, you must use an accurate gram scale to weigh out parts A and B. If using a rubber that is mixed by volume, be as accurate as you can. A product's mix ratio will also affect how a mold rubber is sold. First, know that SmoothOn rubbers and plastics come in different size containers that range from trial units to gallon units to 5 gallon units to 55 gallon drum units and larger. When you order a gallon unit of a rubber that has a mix ratio of 1A to 1B, you will receive a gallon container of part A and a gallon container of part B. A gallon unit of a rubber with a 2-to-1 mix ratio comes to you as 2 gallon containers of part A and 1 gallon container of part B. If you order a gallon unit of a rubber with a mix ratio of 10-to-1, you will receive a gallon container of part A and a pint container of part B. Pot life, also known as working time, lets you know the amount of time you have to mix and apply mold rubber before it becomes unworkable. When used at room temperature, most urethane rubbers give you at least 20 minutes to mix and apply. Most silicone rubbers give you at least 45 minutes to mix, vacuum, and apply. What does a product's pot life mean to you? The pot life of rubber and plastic products will vary. Know how much time you have to mix and apply the product you are using. Some products, especially some plastics, are very fast. If you're not careful, your rubber or plastic may set up in your mixing container before you get a chance to apply it. Viscosity defines how well a material flows. The viscosity of water is 0 centipoise. Urethane rubbers have a relatively low viscosity and de-air themselves without vacuuming. High tear strength silicones, on the other hand, have a relatively high viscosity and should be vacuum degassed to prevent air bubbles from appearing in the finished mold. What does a mold rubber's viscosity mean to you? If the viscosity of the mold rubber you are using is above 15,000 centipoise, it probably should be vacuum degassed to prevent air entrapment. Durometer refers to the hardness of a mold rubber and is measured on the Shore A scale. A rubber with a durometer of Shore 10A will feel soft like your skin and will be very flexible and stretchy. A rubber with a durometer of Shore 30A is somewhat harder and less flexible. A Shore 60A durometer rubber will be moderately stiff. And a Shore 90A rubber will feel hard like a car tire and will hardly flex at all. What does the durometer of a mold rubber mean to you in selecting a material for your project? If your model is three-dimensional with intricate detail and deep undercuts, you will want to choose a soft mold rubber with a durometer of no more than Shore 30A. If you choose a rubber with a high durometer to make a mold of this model, you'll have difficulty extracting the original from the finished mold. You'll also have trouble removing castings from the mold. If your original is flat with little intricate detail and no undercuts, you'll want to choose a mold rubber with a high durometer, especially if you are casting an abrasive material like concrete. For most casting scenarios, the harder mold rubber will give you longer mold life. After mixing part A and part B, mold rubber can be poured over a model, brushed onto a model, pressed onto a model with your hands, as in the case of Poyo mold putty, or sprayed onto a model. The rubber then cures to a flexible solid that has captured all of the detail, texture, characteristics, etc. of the original. These mold rubbers are very precise and will reproduce detail down to a fingerprint. While we are on the subject of how mold rubber can be applied, how do you decide the best method for applying rubber to your model? Generally, if your model is small or flat, pouring rubber makes sense because making a pourable mold is convenient. Pouring rubber also requires less labor and takes less time than brushing, pressing, or spraying rubber onto a model. Pouring rubber, however, results in a higher material cost versus the other application methods. What if your model is three-dimensional or multi-dimensional? Or very large? Or perhaps affixed to the side of a building? In many cases, it is really impractical to pour mold rubber over these types of models. With the exception of models mounted to the side of a building or mounted to the ceiling, you could do it, but the material cost of the mold rubber would be very high. Brushing, pressing, or spraying mold rubber onto a model results in savings on the cost of materials. The labor and time required to make these types of molds, however, is more.